this is the point at which all of you who've been sitting there fidgeting and saying, why the hell didn't he ask such and such, now do it. We have microphones set up in front here, one there, and the next hour, in effect, is yours, as is the panel. Don't feel restricted in terms of asking questions. They can be friendly or unfriendly, but if you want to take the position that some of what you have heard here this morning is not in keeping with what you know to be the case or believe to be the case, feel free to argue. My job is to cut you off after about 45 seconds or so, so keep your questions down to a reasonable limit, and we have about an hour. And please identify yourself.
Excuse me one second. I'm going to exert executive privilege here. My name's Tom Siebel. gentlemen, thank you so much. Liam, if you would please describe for us in detail, okay, what, I know that you are a distinguished expert in a number of things, but in particular, having been involved in the forensic analysis of what exactly happened at Stuxnet, and if you could say, you know, who you think was involved, okay? And I think the probability of you getting out of here without handcuffs is pretty low, okay? I mean, it's without handcuffs is pretty high, okay? So I think you're safe. Okay, there are no media here, my friend Michael Hayden will, you know, I'm certain, be restrained. So if you would, you know, kind of carry forth with what you know about that, I think we would all find it fascinating. And for the people running the conference, if you would be so kind as to maybe move these microphones around, because I think it's going to be very difficult for people to get down here, I would appreciate it. Liam, please.
Thank you very much. Well, I'll start with the more difficult question of attribution, and it's a question that we get all the time on Stuxnet. We've probably got it 100,000 times at this stage, but we get it on threats in general about attribution. Attribution is very difficult to do, and what we do in the lab is very black and white. We have 100% evidence that this is true or it's not true, and we don't step outside of those lines. So to get to the point where you could say 100% exactly who is behind a particular threat is very difficult, particularly from the point of view that attackers can misrepresent themselves, misrepresent their location, and misrepresent information that you see as part of your analysis. So we have to take that into consideration as we analyze any threat, and in particular something like Stuxnet, it was very important for us to get that right. So essentially we don't come out and say who's behind a threat unless we're like absolutely 100% certain. We're not 100% certain in Stuxnet. Based on the amount of information that has become public since we did our analysis and since we published our report, I would say it is very likely that the US and Israel was behind it, but I cannot put my hand on my heart and say that we have evidence to be able to back that statement up. So I can't come out and say it was those countries. I'm not particularly looking in Michael Hayden's direction for any particular reason.
Would you also say what happened?
Sure.
What was the sequel? I'm not sure we all know what Stuxnet was and what happened, how it was done. You know, what was the purpose? What was the sequence of events? How was it accomplished? And what was the effect?
And Liam, if I could just interject a note here that is based on no hard knowledge whatsoever, but I am told that the Israelis were dangerously close to launching a kinetic attack against the Iranian nuclear capability, and that it was that factor as much as anything else that convinced the U.S. government to collaborate with them on this enterprise, which you are now going to describe in great detail.
Certainly, yes. I would say that that is quite likely. And actually, one thing that we did find in Stuxnet that made us realize that it was likely the US and also likely legally approved within the US was the fact that there was a cutoff date within Stuxnet that would stop operations, would stop whoever was controlling it, let's say it was the US, it would stop them from running the operation after a certain date. And that date happened to be 2 days before the inauguration of the next president. So, you know, based off of that, you know, you could assume that it is the US, just based off of that information alone. And throughout Stuxnet, there was a lot of capabilities and restrictions put in there that looked like they were legally required to be in there, because we don't normally see them in any other operations that we look at. For example, it could only spread to a certain number of computers, it could only spread for a certain amount of time, things like that, restrictions that we wouldn't normally see. As a matter of fact, there was a huge configuration file where there was 500 different settings that the malware could take. And it looked from looking at that configuration file that these were legal requirements that were put in. So Stuxnet was an operation to disrupt uranium enrichment inside Iran. So it was a self-replicating piece of software. So it was able to autonomously spread from computer to computer. It had 7 different ways of spreading. And some of those were unknown at the time when they were used. And it would crawl around computers looking for a configuration, a specific configuration that it was looking for. The configuration that it was looking for, it turns out you would only ever find that in a uranium enrichment facility. It was looking for specific industrial control equipment, specific models, a specific type of software, and it knew how to disrupt that software and specifically how to make centrifuges spin above their regulated speed. So it's making centrifuges spin at 1400 hertz, and that's too fast for centrifuges. And we believe that if they spun at that speed, they would explode or be damaged, irreparably damaged. It succeeded. It managed to take out over 1,000 centrifuges in Iran. And it was a very sophisticated attack from the very start. And the way the attackers operated was that they would try to get somebody outside of Natanz, because Natanz is a very secure facility and they have what's called an air gap. And the way the attack worked was that they would try to infect people, contractors who are outside of Natanz, who would be traveling into Natanz, who would be bringing laptops or USB keys or sending software into the Natanz facility. And they would try to piggyback inside on those contractors who are coming in. And then when they got inside, then they would spread out throughout the network looking to see what they could find. And when they found the correct configuration, then what they would do is they would record the information that was occurring on the network. They recorded for a month. And then when they launched their attack to make the centrifuges spin too quickly, they would replay that information of normal activity on the network to the operators. So when the operators were looking at their consoles to understand if something was going wrong inside the facility, they wouldn't see that anything was wrong. They would see the normal replayed activity from the previous month. In the meantime, the centrifuges would be spinning too fast, then being slowed to an almost to a standstill, and that would be repeated. So it was a campaign that was launched in I think around 2005, 2006, and it was discovered in 2010. So they had a good 5 or 6 year run of being undiscovered. There was a reconnaissance phase, then there was an active phase where they were doing the disruption. They had multiple different ways of doing this and multiple variants that they used over different years, different strategies to try and affect the equipment. So it was the first time that we'd seen software being used to disrupt physical machinery. And that's sort of the model of attacks that we see used, or that we imagine will be used in other scenarios. It was far more advanced, written by the US, the most capable in offense in the world. It was far more advanced than other threats that we see. But it was a very, very specific. So you might be infected. One of the issues with Stuxnet was that over time it got more aggressive. So initially Stuxnet would only spread to 3 computers and only within a 2-week period. So it was refined in a way, and it was restricted in where it could spread. And over time, it got more aggressive. And you know, according to the research that has been done, not our research, but other research, that was because the Israelis wanted to be they wanted to cause more disruption. And so over time, it got more aggressive. And that's ultimately why it got discovered. Ultimately, it spread to hundreds of thousands of computers all over the world, not just in Iran, but in, you know, India and Pakistan and Australia and UK, France, Germany, US. We found it in energy and nuclear facilities here in the US. But essentially, you wouldn't be a danger unless you had the exact configuration that was required, the exact configuration of centrifuges and equipment that would be found in Iran. So it was a targeted attack, even though it spread far and wide. So that was the, at that time, that was the first significant attack that we could say, we believe firmly, was government-backed. We were able to look at that and say the resources required here, you would need to have, you need to understand how a uranium enrichment facility works, you would need to understand what equipment is attached to that network, you would probably have to have centrifuges, you would have to set up your own facility to test it, make sure it wouldn't go wrong, you had to be able to support XP and Windows 7 and all these different operating systems. It was a really colossal, colossal job. And from that information, we're able to understand that it had to be a government with those resources. And in particularly, if you look at who has the P1 centrifuges from that were used in Iran, in Libya, they used the same P1 centrifuges, and they were confiscated and sent to the US, UK, and Israel. So we know at least those three countries have the exact centrifuges that were used in Iran and would be able to test them out to see exactly what their flaws are, how they operate, what machinery will be needed to run those sorts of facilities. So it was the first, not 100% confirmed, but you know, the first attack where we were very confident it was a government-based attack. And since then, it really has opened Pandora's box. We're now tracking 100 different operations. They're not all trying to target physical machinery, but they're government-backed. We can tell they're government-backed, going after intellectual property, going after financial information, going after medical records, going after everything. So it really did start a whole industry of government-backed threats and intellectual theft and espionage and a conversation about cyber war. What is cyber war? What constitutes an attack? If you destroy some physical machinery, does that constitute an attack? Is that cyber war? That's what Stuxnet was, and it sort of started a whole conversation.
Does anyone want to comment on the irony of the United States being the only country in history to have launched an atomic bomb attack and having spent the past 70 some odd years trying to contain that, and being in this similar position now with regard to cyber war, having been the first country to initiate that kind of a government-sponsored attack, and now being in the awkward position once again of trying to contain it or at least control it? Any thoughts?
I would add that it's definitely ironic, as you mentioned, for the attack piece. But as far as government-backed operations and with espionage, that goes back to the 1980s. In the digital domain, read Cuckoo's Egg, if you're interested, is sort of one of the first ones that we had seen. So to think that the other, so just to add clarification to the comment, to think that other governments weren't being aggressive in this domain before would be naive, but to your point around the first actually attack control systems, yeah, absolutely. And it also makes, in sort of the international policy scene, discussions very difficult when we have discussions around let's make some sort of treaty around not attacking critical infrastructure. That comment around, well, you guys created Stuxnet, comes up religiously.
All right, where's the gentleman who was Bigfooted 15 minutes ago?
Hi, I'm Zach. I'm an MIT Siebel scholar. You know, you talk about the same nation states as being sort of the ones that get mentioned the most, China, the US, Russia. What do you think it is that drives, is it just a GDP, you know, amount of time to invest, or what countries are smaller that have surprising capabilities and why and what caused them to do so, and or non-state actors that for some reason are surprisingly prominent? What sort of drives this capability?
Well, I think there's a low barrier to entry relative to other sophisticated weapon systems. You have to have trained personnel, and that takes a while. But the cost of having those trained personnel, compare that to buying one F-15 or one B-1 bomber, it's a much lower cost of entry than a nuclear weapons program or something like that. I've been to the cyber command of Norway. I've been to the cyber command of Brazil. You shouldn't think that this is just the nation states that we're talking about. It's become a sort of de rigueur if you're a military that can do it, that you do it. It's now normal for an advanced and even some non-advanced nation states to have a cyber capability.
And yet, somebody may want to comment on the Israeli capability, which I understand is quite significant. Or you may not.
I'll say one thing on it, and that is, from my bias, having previously thought that we were pretty good in the U.S. intelligence community, I would say that Israel definitely has significant capabilities, as they've exhibited through operations they've run. But there's a different scale of the problem. I think Israel's made out to be better than they often are, because they get the luxury sometimes of focusing on a couple key countries, where the U.S.'s intelligence operations tend to be more global in footprint.
Let's talk about Israel from the defensive side, though. One thing we haven't said is how hard it is to defend the United States because of our aversion to regulation, but also because of our strength of civil liberties. We don't want the government doing a lot on our networks. And there are lots of connections into the United States, lots of fiber optic connections. Israel, I think last time I looked, had two fiber optic connections going into the country. It's a lot easier to defend Singapore or Israel than it is a country like the United States, where the governments in places like Israel and Singapore, even South Korea, have more legal authority to supervise what goes on the internet. And it is physically an easier proposition because there's less to regulate and less to defend and less to observe. The United States is probably the hardest country in the world to defend in cyberspace.
Okay, next question.
Hello, my name is Nilay Shah, and I was a UIUC Siebel Scholar in 2006.
Excuse me, but it may be that I'm just old and deaf, but you're mumbling a little bit.
Sure, sorry. Nilay Shah, 2006 Siebel Scholar from UIUC. Actually worked there in machine learning and intrusion detection systems. Now work at Intel in sensor security. So actually I had a question about that. In terms of the last 5 years, there's been an explosion, obviously, around machine learning and data science. It's the hottest field, obviously. Does that make us more secure or less secure? Now you're talking about autonomous agents whose algorithms are very difficult to understand. They're not necessarily designed, they're actually learning themselves.
Well, so I'll jump on this one since everybody was quiet. When you look at security, one of the frustrations of security operations is all of us are getting inundated with 5 terabytes of data every single day. A lot of that data we track because we're regulated industries and we need to have every transaction. There's only about 4 or 5 tools at your disposal if you're a security professional to go from 5 terabytes of logs down to what matters most and what's security relevant. And it'll be analytics, it'll be threat data, it might just be really smart humans who understand your business and they've modeled it somehow, but machine learning will be one of those tactics. And we continue to make the avenues of hacking, in my opinion, we make them slimmer and slimmer all the time. The unfortunate reality is the asymmetry is, once there's a hole in a balloon, you don't have a balloon that's useful anymore. Sort of the same in cybersecurity, as we're pushing attackers to a smaller and smaller surface. That being said, a new app might be created tomorrow that's vulnerable and adopted by 5 million people overnight, so there's always going to be a need for that. But no, I think all these models, increase the speed at which we can be responsive to attacks, the speed at which we recognize them, but they're mostly also there to enable the humans behind it to make better decisions faster.
Yeah, I think machine learning should work. You know, it should have great promise. It should have done that by now. And from what I know about the dozen companies that now say they do it, none of them has succeeded.
Yeah, we had this conversation yesterday, actually, that most of the security companies that I know, and Symantec included, use machine learning. And we haven't managed to make it work to a degree where it would significantly solve problems for us. So we use it internally all the time. And we probably solve 70 or 80% of our problem with using machine learning. But getting that extra percentage up is where the difficulty is. So it's being used right now. There may be some new innovations that haven't been incorporated yet. And maybe there'll be some breakthroughs in relation to that. But certainly, I don't know of any major security company that's not using machine learning right now.
Hi, I'm Scott Moore, a Harvard Siebel Scholar. So my question is, there's been a lot of talk about regulations for security operations or private and government responses to security incidences. But to what extent is there just a need to build better software in the first place? And in particular, what can the government or other people do to encourage that? So to make that concrete, right, so in Stuxnet and attacks like that, what can a grid company do about the fact that Siemens shipped them insecure software in the first place?
So I just want to jump in this real quick. So we responded to 401 breaches last year. None of them were a software vulnerability. So it's a misconception, in my opinion. Just realize this. Most nation states aren't sitting there hammering away at the front door trying to break a custom, cybercrime will, but a custom app on the internet. I feel very strongly that the number one way people are breaking in is spear phishing and duping human behavior, and it's features of the software that are being exploited, not necessarily an exploit in the software. So, and then someone else here can talk about downstream liabilities and the challenges with that in regards to first to market versus first, you know, secure to market. But I think it's a misconception that it's vulnerable software being compromised. That being said, if you have vulnerable software, you're hacked day one. Don't think you're going to make it very far. The internet gives you a free pen test every 15 seconds, probably, all right? So, the breaches that are of consequence and impact, I don't see them hacking software. I see them hacking human nature.
Well, let me pick up on that. I agree with everything Kevin said. But there's no requirement, if you're selling software to the federal government or to critical infrastructure, that it be tested before it goes into production. Mode. There's no requirement that you have a third-party software look for known vulnerabilities. There are three or four companies that do this really well, but that have software that tests software for vulnerabilities. But there's no requirement that they be used. You know all about the SDLC process for development of software. There's no requirement that software be developed with the SDLC process. That embeds security in the development process. As we're moving to DevOps for development of software that turns software around in 48 hours and puts it into production, there's no requirement there at all that software be tested or developed in a way that looks for known vulnerabilities. So we're getting software coming into the market all the time that has vulnerabilities like buffer overflow and SQL injection that we've known about for 20 years. That shouldn't be the case. It's also true that most universities, I'd be interested in hearing if I'm wrong from those of you who have been in computer science courses, but most universities today will graduate you with a bachelor's degree or a master's degree in computer science without ever having made you take a single semester course in security. Or without ever beating SDLC, the secure development process, into your head. There's only one undergraduate college in the United States that I know of that requires that every person, in order to graduate, take one semester of cybersecurity, and that's the United States Naval Academy.
And to add on, because I agree as well, This is probably one of the areas that the buying power of the US government can enforce a lot of things to say, if you want to sell to us, you need to be able to go through certain regiments. And we were having this discussion offline earlier that there are people in the community looking into this, like Mudge and his desire to sort of break through the marketing hype and say, well, how long would your product last under certain standard conditions? But I do want to note a misconception with the example given with Siemens, not to just continually try to defend the industry when it is insecure. I will note that a lot of IT security practices don't translate very well to industrial control systems, one of which is the common narrative of, well, they have a bunch of default passwords. Okay, great. You say you have complete administrative control over the human-machine interface. Now make the lights blink. There's a giant gap in between those two things. And on a risk perspective, you might be much more concerned about an operator forgetting their password and not being able to bring down a physical system that's going to kill somebody than Russia getting down to the actual control system network and going, damn, they've got a password. You know, so you've got to actually look through the risk scenarios on those.
I would say there's three things here. There's one is we've learned a lot in the last 10 years, maybe the last 5 years, in development of how to do things right. And we have some examples of how to do things right with trusted boot, encrypted throughout execution, encrypted updates, making sure you have secure updates, and having a support system in place so that you can roll out updates very easily. We've learned those lessons in the traditional IT community, and the major developers of OSs are moving in that direction. So if we continue to move in that direction and we can spread that message to other operating system builders, then we'll have learned those lessons and spread them to other companies. I don't particularly see that happening outside of the traditional companies that have learned that lesson. And in particular, I don't see that happening in other industries like in industrial control systems or even Internet of Things. Like, Internet of Things is such a huge mess. And you know, you look at these things being released and you're like, we learned these lessons, we know this. Like, you know, all you have to do is follow the mistakes other people made and just follow what they did and you'll be okay. So I think that is a huge problem, but I think if we move in the right direction there, will be okay for the future, but we still have a huge, huge legacy problem, and in particularly with things like the electrical grid, industrial control systems, where things have been up and operating for 30, 40 years or longer. They work, they're reliable, they're producing electricity, they're shipping it. There's no problem with that. How do you address that issue? That's a completely separate issue where the lessons that we've learned for the last 5 years are almost impossible to apply to that sort of scenario.
Yeah, and I just want to opine too. I remember years ago somebody gave a briefing on there's laws on how to build bridges, so there should be laws on how to build software. And I'm pretty sure we know how to use a bridge. It follows the laws of physics and you cross it. How do you use Windows? How many different people are going to use it? In what ways are going to use it? How many people are running applications? I would argue the Windows operating system is a far larger project by humanity than any bridge we've ever built. It will be very hard for us. And by the way, when you start splitting hairs on what's something you need to patch based on security versus an actual feature, believe it or not, there's some complexity there. You want a document that when you open it can populate itself with GIFs and JPEGs and graphics from the internet and audio files from multiple sites and maybe even dynamic and change. It's tough. So I'm on the side of software development, get it out. That being said, I see major problems in the protocols used for authentication and identity management. And if you have anonymity on your network, it's hard to secure it. And a lot of the widgets being developed that are web-based for, you know, like web-based refrigerators, I'm sure there's not great authentication for those.
Just to counter that a little bit, if you look at how much it costs to buy an exploit for different operating systems, I actually don't know what the cost for a current Windows exploit is, but the cost for an exploit for iOS is $1 million. And that, just looking at that tells you how difficult it is to get into a system like that versus Windows or something else, right? So just based off of that, you can see that they're doing something right there. You know, just based off of the economics. So we need more of that.
Well, I think the price for all zero days is going up. And when we respond to a zero-day attack or an attack that does not have a patch made for it yet, I would say it's in the hands of a nation state already by the time we see it.
Does any of this have any, is any of this generational? In other words, my perception would be that a lot of chief executive officers and COOs and CFOs are people who are older and therefore not as savvy, not as sophisticated about security. And theoretically, that should be changing as younger people are taking over those jobs.
Ted, I go to an awful lot of board meetings, I'm sure Kevin does too, where either I'm briefing the board or I'm watching somebody brief the board about cybersecurity, and the board is checking the box. They've had a briefing on cybersecurity. Right. They understand not one word of what's being said.
Yeah, I agree. Well, I think if you take the internet away for a day at work, all your employees under 40 will go home. It's like oxygen. If they can't get to their Facebook page, can't get to their Gmail, they're not sticking around. So I think that the generational gap, quite frankly, is what privacy means to people. The less private you are, the easier you are to be compromised in cyberspace. So I think a lot of the gaps and holes we see in the break-ins are because anyone under the age of 40 puts 99% of their life somewhere on the internet. That's the fodder used by great attackers to be able to break into organizations. So I actually see it as
the other way around.
Yeah, the holes are being made by the folks that put their whole lives out on the internet and trust a faceless environment for their relationships and their emotional responses to things, even though it's faceless and anonymous. And people over 40 may not get the tech, but you know they understand. I think there's a real complexity. We all live connected now. And I think that what I see in the generation is the biggest difference I see isn't the misunderstanding of tech, it's the definition of privacy.
I would say, you know, again, to counter that a little bit, you know, when I go and I talk to people who work in industrial control systems, all the people on the ground, they get it. They all know the problems. They all know, actually, a lot of times how to fix it. It's convincing the next layer up that, hey, we have to do this, right, and convincing them that this is a problem and this is where you should be spending your money is really where the issue is. I'm hoping that has gotten better since the Sony attack. I mean, that was really shed a lot of light and got a lot of C-level executives scared about cybersecurity and wanting to invest in cybersecurity. But I definitely see a gap there still.
Well, I've dusted off my manual typewriter. Do we have? Yes, hello. Go ahead, sir.
Hello. Okay. Hi. My name is Pedro. I'm a Siebel scholar from the University of Illinois. My question is about independent hacking groups like Anonymous. So what's your opinion about them? You know, they work based on altruistic purposes, or so they claim. And what role do they play in the discussion we're having right now? You know, can they tip the scale? They're a non-state actor, so you know, if they were to perform an attack, who are we gonna to retaliate against because you know they're spread out throughout the world?
Yeah, for Anonymous, I would say that for a lot of the attacks we're talking about here, a lot of coordination and pre-planning and time and resources is needed to carry them out. And that's not what Anonymous's strength is. So they can self-organize and they can launch short-term attacks and they can pick effective ways to use the resources that they have. But we're not, you know, they don't have the sort of resources, time, commitment, money, planning, knowledge that would be needed for launching attacks, for example, on scale of affecting the electric grid to a significant extent. But that's not to say that they can't be very effective in what they do. They know what their strengths are and they play to those strengths. They look for a weakness, some unusual way to attack a company, like, for example, release information about them, dox them, things like that. They have effective ways of working, but not at the level that, I mean, we've been discussing here.
Let's also realize that sometimes groups that pretend to be non-state actors, like perhaps Anonymous, may actually be influenced by states. Julian Assange is the face of WikiLeaks and pretends to be an individual, a non-state actor. Julian Assange is receiving hundreds of thousands of dollars from Russia for his program on Russian propaganda TV. I think there's a lot of reason to doubt that some of these people who pretend to be non-state actors don't have some state influence over them.
Question?
Hi, I'm Damian Wisniewski, MIT Sloan Scholar of 2009. Getting to the political dimensions, because it seems like a lot of this comes down to politics, at least sounds like, from the most dangerous attacks. Russia and China coming up a lot. How do you feel, or what, can you sort of model out for us what the changing attitudes of the current administration, what effects those have on both of those countries, and what we might expect to see from cyber attacks and the changes in the environment based on that?
You want to just say no change, right?
I think there are people in Moscow and Beijing right now who are scratching their heads trying to figure that out. And there are probably people five blocks from here in the executive office building on the White House compound that are trying to figure that out. So I don't know is the answer. I am deeply disturbed, however, by a clear pattern of the Russian government hacking not just our election, but also they're currently going after the French election, which is coming up shortly. They're already starting on the German election, which is later in the year. When I say hacking the election, I don't mean they're hacking into the voting machines and changing the numbers. That turns out to be really hard to do, at least in the United States, on any scale. What they have done is they've created thousands, tens of thousands, of false identities on Facebook and Twitter. And they are taking fake news generated by Russian propaganda and micro-targeting that to citizens in certain geographic regions and citizens with certain demographic profiles. And you know, for example, I will give you one example. Haitian Americans who are registered to vote in Dade County in Florida, shortly before the election, were hit with false news stories about what the Clinton what the Clinton Foundation had done in Haiti. Actually, most of what the Clinton Foundation had done in Haiti was great, but this gave the impression that quite the opposite. There's a whole pattern of that. That's just the tip of the iceberg. So when I talk about the Russians hacking democracies, it's not that they're so much, you know, doing kompromat by going into the DNC and publishing those emails. I don't think that had much effect. But I do think their manipulation of social media, the government of Russia's manipulation of social media in the United States through fake news and false identities, I think had an effect on our election. It's happening now in France, it's happening now in Germany, and that's a problem.
Mike Smith, retired from the Department of Energy.
I've lost my total power here. I only have one finger, but go ahead. That's all right.
My question is for Rob about Ukraine. You mentioned earlier about, I think, Mr. Clarke, you'd asked about if they had the ability to cause physical damage. Could you clarify that? Because, I mean, I think it's a false assumption that there wasn't physical damage. In other words, from Shamoon to the wiper of the firmware in Ukraine, are we tied up with terminology here and realize there was physical damage if you render it inoperable?
Yeah, absolutely. So my point to Dick was more on the discussion that he was referring to with physically destroying turbines and generators and, yeah, and centrifuges. There absolutely was destruction elements in Ukraine in rendering systems inoperable. To not to orchestrate their attack, but potentially to amplify the amount of downtime experienced, they spread a piece of malware called Kill Disk along somewhere around 500 to 600 Windows systems across three different regions in Ukraine, three different substation systems, distribution management systems. And that led to the deletion of those operating systems, and they were inoperable. And probably more concerning was they have a device in the electric power industry titled a serial to Ethernet converter. Basically, when we have a control center send communications to a substation, it's done over Ethernet, over the internet, or some dedicated fiber. But when it gets down to the control systems, you're dealing a lot with serial protocols usually. So the serial translation that needs to occur is done at a serial to Ethernet converter. The more concerning aspect in this attack is they profiled, the adversaries profiled those devices and developed specific malicious firmware for those devices. And when it came time to do an attack, they had a 100% success ratio around on around the 30 devices that were networked to make sure that they were completely disabled. So there wasn't physical destruction, but to your point very clearly, there was a denial of service that was due to the fact that they are no longer operable and they couldn't even be recovered by the vendor.
Question up there in about the sixth row.
So this is right over here. Mike Newborn with McKinsey & Company. There's a lot of fear, uncertainty, and doubt, and we've heard a lot of examples on stage today about whether it's 400 investigations a year that Kevin's seeing in his organization to, you know, massive Internet of Things denial of service attacks. And I'm just curious, in what time span do you see the next 9/11 version of cyber happening that's a wake-up call that actually really causes a change to the same extent that we saw in 9/11?
I mean, a quick opinion on that, and I'd love to hear everybody's had to answer this question before. I think, first off, the next Cyber 11, 9/11-like attack, I think we're gonna have bigger problems. I think when the modern nation brings its capability to bear in cyberspace, we may already have something else going on kinetically at that time frame. Robert, you were talking earlier about the attacks on the utilities. I think I'm in agreement that lone actors today, I think, would fail. They wouldn't get the intended results if they tried to bring the grid down today like a modern nation would. I think we'd see the shot across the bow. We'd see a couple failures first, and my firm has not seen those yet. Let's hope that's the case. But every time I back into the worst case scenario in cyber, I feel that there's deterrence for worst case scenario outside of cyberspace. If you bring down a utility, I think the international community would work with you to figure out who actually did that. And I'd hope there'd be risks or repercussions of that activity. So my concern will be the next modern war, there'll be a cyber component to it that could be pretty devastating. And I don't think we can model that before it happens.
Kevin,
yeah, I would certainly agree with that. I would think that there'll be other conflict going on when we see an event of that scale. But I would also point out the fact that it seems that the US doesn't care unless it happens on US soil. And seeing what happened in Ukraine should be a type of 9/11 event for other countries. But in my impression, it's treated like, oh, well, that was Ukraine and that was far away and we don't really need to be concerned about that. I couldn't put a time span on when exactly we're going to see it.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I would note that the industry at writ large, and I refer to more of the technical industry, not necessarily the DC and policymakers, but the technical industry consistently looks for what's going to be the wake-up call. And at some point, we just have to realize there is no magic moment that changes the industry. I mean, you would expect the compromise of the elections or blowing up of centrifuges or bringing down of power grids. I mean, name your scenario, and it should have been some wake-up call, as mentioned. I think the analogy for Cyber 9/11, Cyber Pearl Harbor is useful for policy discussions because of the impact that comes, but isn't going to change the technical industry and isn't necessarily as useful of an analogy there.
I think we've all thought many times that the wake-up call occurred and the patient is still asleep. So I don't like the analogy of 9/11 just personally because 3,000 more than 3,000 people died on 9/11. And that can't be the analogy, because in cyber attacks, people may die, but it's not gonna be on that scale. And there's a big difference between thousands of people dying and infrastructure being damaged. Having said that, I agree with Kevin that we are not going to see a full-scale cyber war absent a full-scale war. Nation states do not go out and test their new weapons. Oh, let's have a war because we got a new weapon. That doesn't happen too often. I think, however, when you see nations that have sophisticated cyber capability go to war with each other in a traditional sense, cyber is going to play a big part of that, and an unknown part, particularly if the weapon systems involved are hacked. Now, we've talked a lot here about hacking the power grid, and that's important. But what we don't really know is the extent to which nation states have hacked each other's weapon systems. And when the time comes and a commander-in-chief says, go do this, if something happens and those weapon systems don't work. We don't know that. And that's an aspect of cyber war that I think gets insufficient attention.
Let me just add a variation on the question here. We've sort of put it in terms of the two ends of the capability spectrum. Mm-hmm. What about those in the middle? What about a nation like North Korea, which I don't think can be held to the normal rules of sane action? And their capabilities are not insignificant. Mm-hmm. Take the same question and apply it to, let's say, North Korea, or under different circumstances, in Iran. I mean, what's interesting to me about Iran's reaction to Stuxnet was not directed against the United States or against Israel, but against Saudi Arabia,
yeah,
against Aramco. So they were very subtle in the manner in which they replied. I'm not sure we could expect that kind of subtlety from North Korea.
Well, North Korea has already done attacks in South Korea. They've taken TV stations off the air. They've taken banks offline. And what's interesting about the North Koreans is that they don't do the attacks from North Korea because there's kind of no internet there. What they do is attacks sometimes from China. Question, does the Chinese government know about that? Do they acquiesce in that? And sometimes from South Korea. So I think it is highly likely that if there were a dust-up, and it wouldn't even have to be a full-scale war, but a dust-up between North and South Korea, that there would be significant cyber attacks on infrastructure in South Korea.
And to points of what actually concerns me on a day-to-day basis with grid attacks, as mentioned, there's really two scenarios that do concern me. One is the one you're talking about, Iran, North Korea, these up-and-coming states in the digital capacity. Iran very, very focusedly targeted major portions of infrastructure in 2013 and 2014. There was no evidence to show that the grid itself was compromised, but they were compromising integrator systems and those that were developing system engineering documents and the things you would have to do a destructive attack. So just from the extreme of they're showing the interest and knowledge required, that's concerning. But the other concerning thing, which maybe hasn't been discussed too much, and one that concerns me personally, is intelligence teams compromising these organizations to gather intelligence, never meaning to do an attack, but maybe accidentally disrupting very sensitive systems. And there's precedents for this. In 2014, there was an attack on a German steel facility, obviously in Germany. And in that case, looking at what evidence is available, it never became clear that they intended to attack anything. It looked as if they were only stealing off intellectual property as it related to systems and steel production. And they accidentally, potentially, knocked over very sensitive safety systems and sensors that then led to an uncontrollable event taking place that led to massive physical destruction across the facility, and they're lucky people didn't die. So an intelligence team not understanding the landscape well enough to causing disruption accidentally is a potential scenario. And then how hard of a call is that? Say if it was the US doing it in Russia, hey Putin, we totally meant to spy on you, but we did not mean to kill those 15 people. Hope we're still cool. How does that political dialogue play out? That's a concerning scenario for me.
Question.
Hi.
Can we get him? All right, we'll go ahead and let's get a mic over here, please.
Yeah, while he's walking, I'll just comment. When we respond to these breaches, I'm not sure we see the extent of the capability of the folks doing the attacks either. I've always marveled when we respond to North Korea Are we seeing the boundaries of their capability? We're not even close. Mm-hmm. And then the most sophisticated attacks sometimes leave the victim machines running in an unstable way. So I think the most sophisticated stuff is largely reserved, and that's why we can't predict when that cyber war really happens and it's an all-out, you know, love fest on the internet. We'll see what happens. But I really can't tell you. And the one thing about cyber attacks are portable. I mean, the Russians could email the malware and the methods with a guidebook and make someone who's pretty good great real fast. So that's what we'd have to worry about. But I right now, the industry seeing the most sophisticated attacks would be .mil and, in my opinion, defense industrial base. Mm-hmm.
Hi, Carolyn from Stanford GSB. And my question relates to the nature of collaboration now and going forward. There are some private industry, the FSISAC, kind of leading the way and trying to form that. And there are some also government-led. What does it look like going forward? And what will be the best way to kind of collaborate going forward?
Well, I guess it depends on what you mean by collaboration. There's a lot of collaboration every day on threat intelligence and information sharing, and that's getting better. For a long time, companies were reluctant. CIOs and CISOs and companies were willing to share information about threats, but their lawyers stopped them. That still happens, but there are methods now of anonymizing and sharing that are getting pretty good. So I think collaboration there is good. I think collaboration between the government and industry is getting better, but very often the government still withholds the kind of data that you need to deal with the threat. Collaboration on research, I don't think is all that good. I think most of the research in cybersecurity in the US is venture capital backed. And I don't think it's coordinated in the way with government grants to universities and FFRDCs. So it would be nice if we could do a little bit better of a job on, and Doug Mond can talk about this in the afternoon, about coordinating the research.
All right, we have time for one more question. There's a gentleman over here.
Hi, Josh Bennett, Kellogg, 2005. Just what targets are non-state actors most intent on it, critical infrastructure targets are non-state actors most intent on attacking now? And which ones do you think they're most likely to succeed in, given that energy infrastructure sounds fairly complicated and they may want to do something that is public impactful but lesser degree of difficulty?
I can tell you where we've seen the last few 0 days used. If you have to feed 1.6 billion people, you want heat-tolerant crops and things of that nature, so that'll get targeted. Actually, there's only very few companies that do that, so I feel like I'm ratting out victims here. And if I say the next one, there's only one company that does it. So the bottom line is where we see 0 days expended is what I think matters most to folks in cyberspace. And oddly enough, it has not been critical infrastructure that we've seen. It's been pharma. Bottom line, the health and welfare of 1.6 billion people are at heart when we saw the attacks. Mm. Or very wealthy or influential Americans' email being stolen with pretty clever attacks.
Let me just make two very quick points. One, I'm going to ask you to stay in place because they want to take a photograph of all of you. So don't take this as an opportunity to leave, but do take it as an opportunity to thank our distinguished panelists, who I think have done a phenomenal job. Thank you.